In this talk, I'll be presenting ShapeRank, a new programming language we're developing at F5. ShapeRank is designed for analytics, machine learning, and reactive programming. And its main claim to fame or contribution is the combination of rank polymorphism, streams, with static typing. That is a unique and new combination with interesting properties. You can view ShapeRank as APL meets Dataflow. Either you consider taking an APL family array language and extending it from arrays to streams, or you can view it as a Dataflow language where we've thrown in rank polymorphism, which is the defining characteristic of the APL language family. And that basically means that functions can be written to work polymorphically uniformly over arrays of differing rank, vectors, matrices, high-ranked arrays. And in our case, that applies to streams instead. And we have these multidimensional streams, which we call hyperstreams. So it's a functional language, but it doesn't have user-defined higher-order functions. It has a few built-in ones, just as the APL does. And that is good enough to work and carry us for now. There are no loops or recursion. It's not a Turing complete language. All iteration is accomplished by the implicit lifting over streams, and that's actually good enough to do almost anything you'd ever want to do. Functions are reactive by default. You can declare them to be synchronous, which is useful in analytics scenarios in particular. All values are hyperstreams, just as in an array programming language, all values are arrays. Even scalars are kind of trivial zero-rank arrays. A similar idea with streams. Finite arrays are a special case of these hyperstreams where we happen to know the size of or the length of the stream. And there's a type system, which I won't be talking about much today, which assigns hyperstream types to all these values. Now, the basic idea of extending an array programming language to work with streams is pretty obvious, right? It's the same kind of lifting going on, except you lift it on streams instead of on arrays. And if you have, for example, a stream of integers, you want to negate them, then you apply the negation function pointwise to each value. It's basically calling map on the stream. But there's more to it than that, of course. When we have multiple arguments, then you can view this as zipping the different arguments into a single argument stream, which then has elements, which are argument vectors that are appropriate to feed to the enary function that you're calling. So in our case, we have a binary function plus, and it does what you'd expect on these two streams. And it takes two arguments, so to feed it those two arguments, we basically zip the two input streams into a stream of pairs. But that masks over something rather subtle that's going on, which is that now essentially zip is implicitly doing the synchronization of these two streams. If they have values arriving at different rates, and we need a one-to-one correspondence, we want a value from each of those two streams, we're going to have to wait for the slower one. And so we're essentially doing a synchronization operation. But that's not the only possible interpretation of how to do this. And in fact, it isn't the one that we usually use. By default, we're reactive. And that comes down to using a reactive version of zip that will produce a new zipped value on its result stream every time any one of its input streams has a new element. And that's what we want in the reactive case. We want to trigger new values whenever anything changes. So if we again have two streams, but they don't have the same number of values available, so tens has three values and hundreds has two values, and we add them, then we will basically add pointwise the first two, and when we have to produce a third one, we'll see that one of the streams has a new value, and we can use that, and we're going to use the old value from the other one, and so the third element of our result stream is 230. And that's sort of the reactive behavior that we actually use by default. Now, the choice of whether to use reactive or synchronous behavior is in the function declaration. Our default semantics are reactive, but you can prefix a function with a keyword sync, and it behaves in the synchronous manner, and that's useful. We might do it differently in the future, but this seems to work well enough. I mean, you could choose to make this choice per argument. You could choose to make it at the call site, but at the moment we make it at the function declaration, and that seems to work pretty well. So to give you a slightly more substantial example, I'm going to basically give you a simple build system. And to build a build system with ShapeRank turns out to be pretty easy. You need a few external functions to talk to the real world out there, to call compilers and so forth. Then you write a build script. Just tell us what you want to build, how you're going to build it, what calls, what compilers are called with what arguments. And the reactive semantics of the language will make it act as a makefile, as something that will continuously rebuild this thing as things change. So this graph shows a very simple scenario with four different target files that you're trying to compile. Yeah, they're color-coded, they have dependencies between them. And so the data flow graph here is get the file, feed it into a compiler, and then link the results from all the compilers. And essentially all builds are variations on this. It's essentially a very simple data flow program. Now here's one of our external functions. This is its signature. It's called getFile, and it takes the file path of a file we want to access and produces a stream of strings as results. And the stream basically will have a new element on it every time the file indicated by the file path changes. So it's basically a way of providing us with a file watcher. The thing is, this element on the stream will be the original name of the file. So it basically echoes its argument every time the underlying file changes. Then we have an external function to call the C compiler, takes the name of a file to compile, takes a list of dependencies, again, their names, has a string that might give other compiler flags, and the string it returns us is the name of the output file. We'll see why that's convenient in just a moment. Now we can write an actual ShapeRank function. It takes the same arguments as Clang. It's a wrapper around the Clang function, but it does the interesting work here because take the first argument, file path, before it passes it on, it calls getFile on it. So the actual argument to Clang is now a stream of file paths. They're all identical, but you get a new element on the stream every time the underlying file has changed. And because we're mapping Clang onto the arguments through the lifting that's implicit in this language, Clang will get called every time that stream has a new value, which means it'll get called on this file path every time the underlying file changes. Something similar happens with the dependencies, the second argument. We first call getFile on that dependency list, and that will give us a list, or a vector, if you will, of streams, each stream indicating changes to that particular dependency. Then we zip that so that we get a stream of lists. Every element in the result of zip will be a list of the names of the various dependencies, but there'll be a new one every time any one of those dependencies changed, because we're doing this reactive zip that I mentioned earlier. We'll have a link function that works the same way. I haven't shown you the external basic link function, but it's basically a very similar idea. And it takes the name of the target, the binary we wish to produce. It takes a list of dependencies where all the dependencies are actually streams in this case, because they're going to be the result of compilations out of CC. And that's why inside this we zip them to produce a stream again. Now the way it'll work is through the code that you see on one side of the slide. And on the other side I have the equivalent command line code that you would have written manually to just build it. Every file, again color-coded, has a line on the command line that compiles it with whatever dependencies it has. And then there's finally a line to call the compiler as a linker and combine them all. And the ShapeRank code does the same thing. We call link. We give it the name of the result, and we give it a list of all the calls to the individual compilations, each one with its own file to compile and its list of dependencies and compiler flags. Each one of these will return a stream, so we're going to get this list of streams, as I explained, which is what link expects. It will massage that into a stream of arguments to basic link, which will provoke the linker every time any one of these dependencies change. Here's a complete program. It's pretty much what you've seen before, except for the program header, which you have not seen before. And the program header declares all the three external functions because they're basically modeled as arguments to the program. So there has to be some command line tooling that actually feeds those external functions in. But from ShapeRank's perspective, they're just arguments to the program, and they can be used and invoked within it. And that's our complete implementation. And it's prototypical of a large range of workflow applications. And it has the advantage that now we have this thing. It works the way you want, in the sense that it will trigger whenever there's a change. It'll only do the minimum work, because only the pieces that change trigger new streams that will trigger other pieces. So only the dependencies force new computation. You don't have to redo the whole build every time. If you have a mature implementation, you also will have the benefit that this can be done in parallel. So that's one kind of application that we have in mind. Analytics are others, where we have data streams that need to be processed and forwards, and there that's where the synchronous stuff is sometimes useful. In machine learning, I've certainly seen scenarios where you have multiple models that need to be interconnected and fed from actual sensor streams and things like that, for example, in autonomous vehicles. And within the AI models, you find that there's higher dimensional stuff that's hard to keep track of, that you'd rather express in a high-level way and have the type system track for you. I haven't talked about that, but that's also part of the goal of the language. And if you combine all this and leverage the type system so that you can actually map things intelligently onto GPUs, etc., then we may have something really useful here. So right now, we just have a very naive proof-of-concept compiler, interpreter, really. It's open source. The design is all subject to change. We plan to extend it with query support, particularly for the analytics scenarios, possibly a streaming SQL-like thing, possibly a data log thing, really too early to say. And of course, yes, a performant implementation is the big challenge, which I hope to reach someday. Right now, we're light years away from that. Thank you for your attention, and if you have any questions, let me know. Thanks.